Hi guys, in this video I'm going to show some moody telephoto foggy forest photography, and I'm going to share an editing tip with you that might completely change or at least inspire you to approach foggy forest photography in a new and broader way. So very close to where my in-laws live, there is this row of old oak trees. Each time Sophie and I go for a walk, we pass these trees and they always catch my interest. Although I prefer to photograph trees with leaves on, I kind of reached the conclusion that to catch those beautiful gnarly shapes of these old oaks, I would have to do so during winter. As the trees are placed between two hills, you actually photograph the top of the trees straight on and you have a hill and a forest behind them. I have learned and experienced that this is a very good thing, because with a very heavy layer of fog you should in theory be able to get a fantastic separation to the background and create a strong sense of depth. A little bit like this shot here, which is one of my all-time favorite forest photos. Over the past 1.5 years I've got a decent feeling with forest photography during fog and what you can do with it in post-processing. So when I actually got a morning with really thick fog a few days after New Year's, I went out to photograph the trees. I honestly wasn't sure whether there would be a video in it, so I decided against my better judgment and didn't film it. Though you probably wouldn't have been able to see much anyway, as it was really foggy, as you can see on these raw files. So because I was positioned as I was on that top of the hill and shooting into the top of the trees, I was shooting with my Sony 100-400 and my Tamron 28-200. It's more of testing the lens out, I will talk about it later. But the point was, I was shooting with the telephoto, so I could really zoom in to all those gnarly branches that just looked, yeah, so fairy tale like in the fog. On top of that, I wouldn't say I was struggling with the composition, but a lot of it was guesswork, simply just because it was just so foggy. I could see like the main branches through the fog, but there was a lot of the smaller details that I couldn't really decipher through the fog. So I took a lot of photos simply just to make sure that I got something that was usable when I got back to the computer. And in regard to the settings, it is just what I always do. I was shooting in aperture priority. I shot at a fairly close down aperture between f11 and f16, simply just to get the entire tree in focus with the foreground branches and the background branches of the tree. I also shot at as a low ISO as absolutely possible, ISO 50, ISO 100, because I knew that when I'm going to edit, which I will show in just a minute, I'm going to bring out a lot of noise in the photos. So in that way, I needed to have the cleanest possible base file as possible. I also photographed on a tripod to nullify the significance of the shutter speed. So I could shoot at like 0.5 seconds, 2 seconds or longer if it was necessary to get the optimal exposure. As you can see here on all the photos here, they are very, very flat due to all the fog. And that is of course completely natural. The point here is to bring in a lot of contrast so I can bring out all those details. And of all the photos I took this morning, the one I think I like the most is this one. So when I open it in Camera Raw, and I usually edit in Camera Raw, you can do the exact same things in Lightroom. And now that Camera Raw has got its new interface, Camera Raw and Lightroom are almost the same. So if you want to bring in some contrast, you can of course like bring up the contrast slider. It's just the problem here that it doesn't really give much. We don't remove that flatness from the scene. You can see our histogram is up here. And yeah, it's very much on the same place. If I bring down the blacks, then we can start to see we are spreading out the tones of the histogram, and we can even change the temperature here. But in all honesty, like, it is just not really where I want it. I can always go in and make all sorts of local adjustments and use the gradient filters and so forth. But if you really really want to see this pop, there's one slider that does this entire job for you, and it's the DH slider. And this is just magical. Look at that. This here is just... When I found out how great the DH slider is for trees and fog, like, my entire approach to how I photograph trees in fog changed. Because the DH slider, yeah, it removes the fog magically. I'm not even sure how the algorithm is designed, but as you can see, all the branches that are closer to us is obviously more contrasty and more punchy, and you can really see them. However, we still have a really nice dehazed effect, or yeah, not dehazed, a hazed effect here in the background. It is very easy to see that we have a good amount of fog in the background. So photographing in very thick fog and combining it with the dehaze slider is just magical. So when I finished up all my editing here in Camera Raw, I probably brought down the blacks a little bit, maybe added a bit of contrast, and then did some local adjustments just to remove some of the blues here in the corner up here and here, and of course, like, removing chromatic aberration and so forth. So when I'm done with my Camera Raw, I move everything into Photoshop. So we are now in Photoshop, and this is how my file looked out of Camera Raw. The first things I usually do is I use my plugin to pass denoise to remove the noise here. When I zoom all the way in, you can see that without my filter, my Topaz noise, there's quite a lot of noise. But then I use it to just clean up the photo. After that, you can see here all these dust spots. I cleaned those up too. When you do use the dehaze slider in Camera Raw or Lightroom, then all the dust you have on your sensor becomes really, really visible. So you do yourself a favor by cleaning your sensor before photographing, but of course you can remove it afterwards. So that's what I did, cleaned up the photo. So I got rid of all those small spots. And after that, I simply just started to do a lot of layers and adjustments throughout the photo, simply just to balance it all and all the way up through. I even sharpened it even more, just with a very classic, go to filter, other high pass filter here. It's a classic way to sharpen your photos. There's a ton of videos about that on YouTube. And here I just made another Camera Raw filter just to change a little bit of the white balance and a few other things. I think it was a little bit too green still here, so I just changed that a bit, added a bit of vignetting, and even more, changed the hue and saturation a little bit, and fixed a little bit more up here in the corner, and simply just finished it up like this. When I do my editing, I also often change to a white background, simply just to see how the tones work against a white background. But generally, this here is the final photo from this morning, probably my favorite photo. So I'm going to show this full now, along with a couple of more photos. So you might ask how often I actually use this effect. And I more or less at least use the dehaze slider on almost all my photos that I photograph in a forest when there's very thick fog, one way or another. Here are a few more examples where I have used this technique here, and yeah, it's just really, really powerful to bring out those details, yet still keep that very atmospheric and eerie, yeah, atmosphere. So if you want to learn even more about how I edit my photos, be sure to sign up to my 28 plus videos course, Photoshop for Landscape Photographers. That's a huge mouthful each time I say it, but nevertheless, this is here where I simply just show you everything I do when it comes to editing. I teach you all the basic stuff all the way through all the advanced stuff. Everything from basic masking in Photoshop, how the program works, all the way up through very advanced masking using luminosity masks. Yet I really try to keep it as simple as possible. There's no reason to make everything harder than it really is. And one of the best things is you don't even need to use all sorts of different plugins. When you have enrolled in my course, I show you how to do it all in Camera Raw and Photoshop. And if you want to learn a lot about composition, be sure to get my two ebooks. In these ebooks, I really break down composition to its most basic elements. And in the final chapter of each of the ebooks, I bring everything together that I have talked about in the ebook. So if you want to learn about composition, those ebooks are the ones to check out. So thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it, even though there was not so much in the field. But as I can see on all the other landscape photographers on YouTube, most of us are doing studio stuff anyway at this time of year. If you enjoyed it, I would highly appreciate both a like and a comment. And if you want to see even more, be sure to subscribe to the channel. It's foggy outside, so I will go out and photograph some more.